Our topic for today is on continuous delivery on Kubernetes using Spinnaker. In today's webinar, we will start with an introduction to the Kubernetes pipeline, followed by a live demonstration on how to install and configure the pipeline. We will also demonstrate how changes are delivered to a pipeline across multiple environments, and also how monitoring and observability are achieved through Prometheus and Elasticsearch stack. We have significantly improved the WSO2 Helm charts. These Helm charts are hosted in the WSO2 Helm chart repository, which can be found at this URL. These charts are created in a highly configurable manner where it is possible to choose between Docker images hosted at Docker Hub or Docker images hosted at docker.wso2.com private registry, which contains WSO2 updates. Also, it is possible to integrate with Elasticsearch for logging and Prometheus for monitoring. So, continuous integration is the process of converting source code into deployable artifacts, while continuous deployment is the process of deploying those artifacts into different environments. A CI/CD pipeline is an end-to-end process that does both continuous integration and continuous deployment. Let's talk about the WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline. The WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline enables running DevOps seamlessly for WSO2 products running on Kubernetes. It is easy to start it with minimal safe default configuration. Through this, it is possible to deliver changes and updates across multiple environments and observe logs and monitor the performance of each environment. Based on GitOps model, the WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline considers it as the source of truth for the development deployments. WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline make use of the following well-established tools like Jenkins, Elasticsearch Stack, Prometheus, and Spinnaker. We have chosen Spinnaker as the continuous deployment tool. It is a multi-cloud deployment tool. It has native support for deploying into most cloud environments and has the best practices for cloud deployments built in. Also, Spinnaker is backed by a grown community. And it has several features such as access control configuration per application, support for ingesting events from Docker registries, cross-cluster orchestration, and many more features you would have to build on top of Kubernetes yourself. Now, let me explain the architecture of WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline. WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline itself running on Kubernetes. It uses Jenkins for continuous integration and Spinnaker for continuous deployment. Also, there's a cluster-wide Elastic stack and Prometheus operator for centralized logging and performance monitoring of the environment. There are two GitHub repositories that act as the source of truth of the deployments. The artifact source repository contains the Docker file, which can be used to customize the base images from WSO2. This can be used to add or build artifact to be used in the deployment. The chart source repository contains override for the Helm chart configuration. There is also a private Docker registry to store the customized images. For a product deployment to be created or updated, Spinnaker expects a new Helm chart or a new Docker image. There are three ways that an update could be triggered by Spinnaker. The first one is the Helm chart configuration are changed in the GitHub chart source repository. Jenkins pushes this Helm chart and overridden configuration to Spinnaker. Spinnaker will create or update the dev environment. After that, the pipeline prompts the user to approve the changes to the staging environment. Once the staging environment is running and all tests are passed, the pipeline prompts the user for a second time to approve changes to the production environment. The second way is a cron job in Jenkins, which pulls the base image to create a customized image and pushes into the private Docker registry. Spinnaker listens to the change and pulls the updated image and updates the relevant environment as mentioned before. The third way is when a new artifact is added to the Docker file in the GitHub artifact source repository, and same as before, a customized image is pushed to the private Docker registry and Spinnaker will deploy it. Please use this slide for later reference. Okay, let's move on to the live demonstration and see how easy it is to work with the pipeline. Over to you, Akif.
Thank you, Thilina. So in this section, we'll be doing a small live demo on how we can install and configure the Kubernetes pipeline, as well as how we can send some simple changes through the pipeline to different environments. So to get started, there are some prerequisites here. You would need a Kubernetes cluster, since the entire cluster and the product deployments need to be deployed into a Kubernetes cluster. This cluster needs to have Nginx ingress controller installed, and we have tested the current pipeline with the version 0.22. We'll also need Helm, since we are using Helm as the deployment manager for deploying the pipeline. We'd also need a private registry to store your custom images that you have built on top of the WSO2 base image. And in this case, we are using a Docker Hub account. Additionally, you have the chart source repository and the artifact source repository. So if you would like to change the content and see how the build is triggered, you can fork these two repositories and use them in the deployment. The first step in getting the pipeline, installing the pipeline, is to download, is to provide a values YAML to configure your private Docker registry and GitHub and your application configurations on top of the plain WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline chart. So in this URL, we have provided a sample chart YAML, a values YAML that can be used to get started with the enterprise integrator pattern one, which is enterprise integrator with analytics. And once you have that done, you have to fill this information in. That's your registry username, password, email, and you can provide an email where you would like to receive email notifications regarding the build. You can also have your GitHub credentials if you're using a private GitHub repository. The second step would be to add the WSO2 Helm repository to your Helm client, and then you can use the Helm commands to install the pipeline as a Helm release. This is the sample values file that we'll be using today, and it contains your GitHub credentials, information to your registry, that's your credentials, and you would also need to configure the Spinnaker chart to point to your correct registry as well. And you can see that at the end, you have deployed the applications. So to define this application section, you have the name of the application. So in this case, we have used WSO2EI as the name of the application. We can also point to where the test scripts reside inside the chart source repository. So these are the tests which will be run after the staging environment is created. You also specify what chart should be used. So in this case, we are using the EI pattern one chart of version 6.5.03. and this chart is fetched from the WSO2 Helm chart repository. And this is the chart source repository. So we will be changing this to our own organization so that we can edit it. Additionally, we define the image repository that is going to be used and to which deployment this image belongs to, and the Docker file, which points to the artifact source repository that you have forked. So in this case, I'll be using my repository as well. So you can specify the base image you want to use. Currently, we are using the image from Docker Hub. You can also use the image from docker.wso2.com as well, if you have a subscription. Once you have filled everything and you have got your values YAML in, the first step to do is to add the WSO2 Helm repo. To add the WSO2 Helm repo, you can use the command helm repo add and pass the parameters name and the URL to point to. In this case, we'll be pointing to the WSO2 Helm chart repository. Once the repo has been added, you can use the command helm repo update to fetch the latest information about the charts available in the remote repository. Once you have updated that, we can do a search to find out what are the charts available in the target repository. In there, we can see that we have the WSO2 product charts as well as the pipeline chart. The next step is to install the Kubernetes pipeline. We can use the command helm install and pass the following parameters: the name of the release, the name of the release, followed by the chart's name, which is WSO2/Kubernetes Pipeline. We can also provide the override values we just defined. And optionally, we can provide the namespace to which this should be deployed onto. Once this has been installed, so for demo purposes and due to time constraints, we'll be using an already deployed release of this pipeline. So once you have installed the pipeline, you can use the command kubectl get ingress to find out the ingresses for each of the tools that we have defined. And once you have got the hosts, you can then set the hostname mappings in your host file. So as you can see in this case, I am setting the host names of Spinnaker, Jenkins, Kibana, and Grafana to this IP address, which we got from the ingress. Once you have done that, you should directly be able to access Spinnaker at this URL. Once you get into the Spinnaker dashboards, Spinnaker is organized into applications. So we'll go into the application section, and inside the application section, you would find your application. Once you go into the application, you would find three tabs, and we'll be focusing on the pipeline and the infrastructure tab. So if we go into the pipelines tab, we will find a list of pipelines that were pre-configured when we install the pipeline, when we install the Kubernetes pipeline chart. In this case, we have a bake manifest pipeline, which with the configuration, and it also gets the latest Docker image, and it bakes those into a single Helm chart and provides it to the deploy dev pipeline. The deploy dev pipeline will then deploy these artifacts into the dev environment. And once it has done that, it will require a manual judgment from the user to proceed to deploy this into the staging environment, which would trigger a staging pipeline. The staging pipeline would continue to deploy this in the staging environment. It'll run the test script you have defined, and it'll again ask for a manual judgment. So if you want to continue this deploying this into your production, you can continue, or you can stop it here. If you do continue, there will be a production pipeline triggered. And if you go to the infrastructure tab, you can see what has been deployed into your existing cluster. So in this case, I have deployed two environments, the WSO2 EI dev environment and the staging environment. And in each of those environments, you can find the deployments and the corresponding pods that are running. And if you go to the load balancers section, you can find all the load balancers that are available for this application. Okay, so that's it about installing and configuring the pipeline. So what we plan to do now is to provide an update. So if we take our cloned, our forked repository, so this was the definition to build our custom image. And if we take a look at the Docker file, what we do is we copy some artifacts into a Carbon Apps folder. And the exact artifact we are copying is the Hello World composite application artifact. So since we have deployed this already, if we query to our gateway endpoint, we should receive a message. And currently the message says Hello World. So our goal in this demo is to change this message by just doing a push to GitHub. Okay. To get started, let's clone our artifact source repository. So you get the URL and we'll clone it into a current workspace. Once you have done that, let's go into the workspace and we'll replace the old artifact with an updated artifact. And we can do a git status. And we can see that the artifact has slightly changed. That's because we have changed the message in the artifact. Then we can do, we can add the artifact and commit it. And then we can push it to our origin repository. Okay, now we have pushed a simple change to GitHub. Let's go back to our GitHub repository. And our latest commit was taken. It was 21 seconds ago. So what would happen then is Jenkins would listen to that change. So if we quickly log into Jenkins, you would find a folder with your application name. And it has a job predefined to build the changes from the from that repository. So we should see that the new build is triggered. Okay, our build has triggered. So if we just go through the log, what it's doing is it's building a customized image and it's tagging with a timestamp and pushing it to our private registry. So it has successfully completed and the image has been pushed to the private registry. Now Spinnaker will be polling to the private registry. So once it sees a new image has been uploaded to that registry, it'll fetch the latest image. It'll get the previous helm chart that it had and it'll combine those two to make a deployable artifact. So as you can see, it has picked up the new image, and it's currently baking those images into a single artifact. And this will soon trigger a pipeline to deploy the changes onto a development environment. So the dev pipeline has started. So it'll create the namespace and deploy the necessary requirements, such as the secrets for the Docker image. And once it's completed, it'll start deploying the new change to the application. And while this is progressing, we can go to our clusters tab, and we can filter by our dev environment. And we can have a look at our integrator deployment, which is currently at version 4. So with the new, when the new deployment has started, you should see a new version pop up here. So let's go back to the pipeline. Okay, so now it has started deploying the artifacts. And you can see that it's using the Helm chart and the new Docker image. And whilst the deployment is going on, we should now see a new version popping up here. So a new version has been created, version 5. It's not stable yet, it's starting up. So the old one is still serving the traffic. So with the old message, hello. So it'll take a couple of minutes for the new pod to start and running. So whilst it's getting started, we'll go into Kibana to check how we can see the logs. Kibana is the visualization part of the Elk stack. So all of the logs can be viewed from here. You can create index patterns to filter by view indexes, and also filter and sort by necessary fields maybe. Once you're in Kibana, you can go into management and index patterns. And to view some of the logs, you have to create an index pattern. So when you create an index pattern, it'll suggest you the available indexes. So you can use a pattern to either capture some of them or only one of them. So I'll use the dev integrator node for this, and I can use the filter by timestamp and create an index pattern. Once the index pattern is created, you can go into the discover tab and you can view the logs for the index pattern that you just created. So in here, you can do stuff like see only the level or the log message, or you can also filter by the time if you want. If you go back to the deployment, you can see that the new deployment is stable and it should start serving traffic. So as you can see that the new pod has also started to serve traffic. And once it's established that it's stable enough, the old pod will go away. So while that happens, let's quickly look at our performance metrics. So we have Grafana as part of the Prometheus stack to view performance metrics. We can log into Grafana using the default credentials. And once you're in Grafana, you can go to manage dashboards. And inside manage dashboards, you'll find a few dashboards. And at the bottom, you'll find three pre-configured dashboards from WSO2. And the first one is for JMX monitoring. So this dashboard will fetch information from Prometheus regarding the JMX statistics for each pod in each environment. So you can filter by the pod and get statistics such as memory usage and also the heap usage. And you also have metrics regarding JVM. There also you can find some graphical representation of the performance statistics. And then you have your probe monitoring dashboard, which monitors the endpoints for each environments to make sure that they are up and running. So currently I only have the dev and the staging environment. So I have it up and running. That's all about performance monitoring. And as you can see here that the version 4 has disappeared and version 5 of the deployment will continue to serve traffic, which is our new message. So that's how you deliver a change, an artifact change through the pipeline. You can also deliver the chart configuration change as well as WSO2 updates throughout the pipeline. So moving back to the presentation, let's discuss how the product deployment is deployed. So if you take a product deployment, it's bundled with a logstash sidecar container. So this will share the logs folder with the actual product deployment. And whenever it sees a new line added to the log file, it'll push the logs to the Elasticsearch master. So this Elasticsearch master is a cluster-wide Elasticsearch master, and it'll index all the logs that it gets from the deployment. So this could be more than one deployments pushing the logs to the Elasticsearch master, and the Elasticsearch master will index them. And as we showed earlier, you can use Kibana to fetch these index logs and create an index pattern to view the logs. This way you can view the logs for the entire cluster in one place. Another tool is Prometheus. So Prometheus will be scraping metrics from our product deployment using some services that we have deployed. These performance statistics are gathered and stored in Prometheus. And as we showed earlier, we use the pre-built Grafana dashboards to fetch information from the Prometheus cluster regarding the JVM, the JMX information, and also the probes. That's all we had regarding the pipelines. If you have any questions, please do ask them.
So we have got some questions. The first one is, do you have support of WSO2 identity server for this deployment on Kubernetes?
So we do have support for WSO2 identity server as well. As you can see in the resources, we have given the links to try it out as well.
So the next question is, here you had multiple installations. Did you install them locally or are you using cloud deployments? We are using cloud deployments.
So if multiple installation, you mean the tools that we use during the pipeline, those are deployed as part of the pipeline. Hope that answered the question. There's another question. On how do we do rollbacks. So I'll quickly show that in the dashboard itself. So if you go into your deployment, you can see your new version and you can just click on here and you can do an undo rollout and you can go to the previous revision as well.
Another question, how to apply cluster and keystore changes? So we can use the Docker file in the artifact source repository and burn the cluster or keystore into the customized image and use that for deployment. So
There's also another question on can the number of environments be changed? So that is possible if you go into our pipeline source repository, you could always edit that and configure that to remove some environments or add new environments by modifying the pipeline.
So we got another question. How can I map different endpoints for Carbon apps in different environments if the images are immutable? So so in this case, CF would be pointed to a fixed Kubernetes service. And in each different environment, you can attach the desired endpoint to the particular service. So CF would be the CF would see a single service in every environment, but those in each environment service would be pointed to different endpoints. So we got another question. How is WSO2 updates embedded into the pipeline? So if you process a subscription, WSO2 subscription, then you can point the pipeline to get the base image from our docker.wso2.com registry, where the images are daily updated. So you can get one updated images from there.
Okay, we'll try to answer some of the questions later. So before we wind up, I'll give a quick recap on what we have done so far. So we talked about what has been introduced into our new Helm charts, the way it's new configurable, and it's possible to integrate it with Elasticsearch and Prometheus. And we talked about what is a CI/CD pipeline and how it combines the both CI part and CD. And we talked about the WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline. So with this presentation, you might have got a good idea on the WSO2 Kubernetes pipeline. It's easy to get started with. So with its quick start configuration, and it's pre-configured with safe defaults. And it supports multiple environments, and it has centralized logging with Elk, and it supports monitoring out of the box with Prometheus, and it's based on the GitOps model, so it's driven by Git, and you can also provide WSO2 updates, and also it's customizable to match user requirements. So if you take something like this. It will drastically reduce the load on a DevOps team, and it'll be easier to get started with and also to maintain this in long term. Then we looked at the tools used in the pipeline. We talked about Jenkins, Spinnaker, Elastic Stack, Prometheus operator. We looked at Spinnaker and why it's important and what are the features it's providing. We also discussed the Kubernetes pipeline architecture. We showed how the three methods of delivering changes and updates to your deployments. And we went through the demo on how to set up, install your Kubernetes pipeline. And we saw how we can configure it to your suit your private registries and your private GitHub accounts. And we saw how easy it is to install it. And we showed you how this interact with Elasticsearch and Prometheus to provide a lot of useful data that is quite important when you are running a production grade deployment such as this. So when there is an update happening, you can in real time view those logs and performance metrics in the pipeline itself. So if you for later reference, you can use these resources. We do have documentation here with the quick start and some advanced use cases on how to use the pipeline. We also have a similar story for identity server as well as the WSO2 micro gateway products as well. And these resources will be shared with you after the webinar. That's all we had for the webinar. And I recommend you to use this since it reduces the effort on integrating a lot of useful tools and maintaining a complex CI/CD pipeline. And thank you for joining our webinar. And that's the last, this is the last webinar of the webinar series on WSO2 updates. Thank you for joining.